Hello, listeners, and welcome back to another episode of the Known and Ever podcast. I'm your host, Natalie Bromley, and we are looking back at 4 points out of the last two games, a 0-0 draw away at Oxford and a 1-0 win at home to Plymouth. The Clarets quietly climbing the way up to second in the league, going about their business in a very unassuming way. I'm joined this week by Rich Steele and George Poole to look at just exactly how Scott Parker is quietly getting the Clarets under the radar and up that championship table. So, listeners, buckle up. Let's go. George, welcome, welcome.
Good evening, folks. How are we all doing?
We're good, thank you. Rich, good evening.
Good evening, Natalie. Good evening, George. Good evening, listeners. I hope you're all well.
I love Rich's openings to our podcasts. He always just comes with just these wonderful greetings that just fill me with warmth. It's very wholesome content here at Known and Ever. Well, just because you gave us such a good introduction, Rich, I'm going to come to you first. George, stand down for a minute, please. And I'm going to pick up, largely directing the conversation here this week, to some of the things that you were putting in our chat this week. You very handily gave us quite a long summary of where you thought we were after last night's victory at home to Plymouth and where we are generally. And I remember reading it and thinking, this is a fantastic structure for the podcast this week. So thank you for that. And you kicked us off with that, Rich, by basically saying, ultimately, a draw away from home is a draw. A win is a win, irrespective of a performance. And the Clarets find themselves second in the championship table.
Yeah, I was catching up on messages because I seem to go to bed ridiculously early and everybody else seems to be up really late at night. So I'm kind of like reading the messages through. So I'm trying to give my summary. I think where we're at the moment is we're picking up points, which is always a fantastic trait of a team. And ultimately, football's about results, isn't it? We can look at the entertainment value. I think I said a talking cheek comment, didn't I? I said, if you want to be entertained, go to the circus. And I did mean it very much tongue in cheek. I hope it didn't come across serious because I said that in response to you, Natalie, didn't I? But
listen, Rich, of all these years, I tend to take these days and pinch yourself. But we have a very safe space at Known and Ever. We're like the worst bunch of siblings you've ever seen in your life.
It's definitely great. George great is the thing. Annoying little brother, as you'll find out on this podcast tonight, probably.
Absolutely.
But
absolutely,
I think I've kind of seen a lot of tweets, and you're either on the side of this is boring, it's rubbish to watch, or it doesn't matter, we're picking up points. And I think it's okay to be somewhere in the middle. I woke up in the morning and you're happy that you've got the 3 points, but I don't think any single Burnley fan, maybe other than George, can actually say that they found that second half entertaining.
No, it wasn't.
And Plymouth contributed to that as well. I thought they played a really dull, boring style of football. And their couple of best chances came from mistakes from us at the back, where we give the ball away and they like quality to finish it. I think the first half an hour, leading up to when we scored, the build-up play was really, really good. It was the best half an hour we've played all season. But our product in the final third was woeful. Let's just be honest, it was woeful.
Yeah, it was.
I don't think we're getting enough players into the box, which then means there's not as many options. You're delaying your cross into the box. And at times, the crossing just didn't literally went either to a Plymouth player's head or a Plymouth player's feet. I think there was one good cross by Pires, which found Collie Oshaw at the start of the first half, and he had a poor finish. So it is very much a team in progress, and we're second. You know, if you look at our performances since the Cardiff game, they're probably not warranting of a team who's second in the Championship, but yet we find ourselves there. And you look at them, I presume we're going to discuss players that are out of the squad, who's going to come back into the squad and the team, which definitely will help. I think that's where we are. We're getting results. It's not like it's like the football's terrible. It's just a bit dull.
Yeah.
But one thing that I'm glad is we've got a little bit of grit about us. Our shape is better. But yesterday, I don't think we even had to defend well against Plymouth.
No.
I actually thought we looked a little bit open and shaky at the back, but they were so poor and lackluster too that they never really hurt or threatened us. I think yesterday was almost one of them, where we've, you know, we've all played football, and when the game's that easy, you can almost just lose that little bit of intensity and you go a bit sloppy.
Yeah, that's a fair point.
Yeah, no, and when that happens, it's really difficult to get that initiative back. And ultimately, we never really looked in trouble, but Plymouth had that corner in like the 97th minute, and it only takes a good ball and a header into the box, and it's 1-1, and you've lost a 3 point. So one thing I do like is Parker's not... He's saying there is positives, but there's also a lot to improve on, where he's, which is a positive. And I think it'll be good on this podcast to kind of like review where we are as a squad too.
I agree. But yeah, we'll do that, Nick. We'll do that in second half.
But with the kind of players we've had available in the last two games, the team's not that great.
No, it's not. Honest. We don't have the strength in depth anymore of the squad. We don't have really amazing quality in all the first choice positions. I think there has been a drop, an understandable drop in quality of the squad, generally speaking. And the backups are either not there at all, hello, left back, or they are really quite a significant drop. I think that's where the concessions have been made. And you've got to remember that, you know, we had, what, 7 players out still again last night, who players who you would argue would probably come into that first team. I'll come back to this point in a minute, but I could listen to Scott Parker's analysis of games on loop for hours and hours and hours. George, counter that, please, because you were like the little Duracell bunny last night. You were absolutely buzzing after that performance. You loved it first half, second half. You loved the battle. You particularly loved their gamesmanship, the game management, as I think those who, when Manchester City do it, get called in the press towards the game. Counter what Rich was saying. Where do you stand on all of this?
Yeah, it's not really a counter to Rich, because I think what Rich's saying is probably all rings true. But I, just from a personal preference, I love the game last night. I thought it were absolutely fantastic. As opposed to in the Premier League, I'm just really enjoying games of football where it's competitive. Yeah. Whether that's both teams being good or both teams, you know, in the second half last night being rubbish, you know.
I'm a just level playing that. Field.
Yeah, I'm loving that balance. I'm finding every game enjoyable to watch, and that even includes the Oxford game, which we'll probably skirt over a bit tonight because there wasn't that much to talk about, but it was still enjoyable. You know, they defended really well to a man. I thought they were set up fantastically well, and they provided a buffer to our probably stifled attack. So I really enjoyed that game, really enjoyed it last night. I thought Parker's comments, like you said, we're bang on the money. He's a very enjoyable guy to listen to because he tells it as it is. And I think that's probably something he's learned in his time out of the game and due to his chasing an experience with Club Bruges. He knows how to connect to the fans, I think, now, compared to maybe when he was a younger manager. He knows just to tell it straight down the line. And he said, first half last night, he thought we were excellent. You know, probably one of the best performances we've seen under him. With this squad, at least, you know, not counting the Luton game. I agreed with him completely there. The first half last night, it was a joy to watch. I really thought we were excellent, except from that final ball. It's that final ball. It's that maybe not having one more man. We really should have gone into half-time 2 or 3 up. And I know it's easy to say that, but we should have done. And the game would have had a completely different look about it. Now, yeah, we did drop off second half. We weren't as good. We were nowhere near as good. But I'm not that bothered because we didn't concede. We still got the 3 points. And as you alluded to, I thought the game management in added time was honestly exemplary. Like we kept it in that corner between Bob Lord and the Jimmy McElroy stand for a good 5 of those 6 minutes. That's not easy to do.
It was a minute and 45 seconds that between them, Jay and Josh Brownhill just didn't let it go out of play. Now, that's a huge amount of experience from two senior players in the squad who absolutely learnt that under Dash, by the way. But for a minute and 45 seconds, they did not let it go out. And like you say, 5 out of 6 minutes, we're in that corner. And that really frustrates Plymouth. I think you're right, George. And do you think one of the summaries that Rich said last night was that, particularly in that first half, it is sometimes difficult to get excited about such incredible build-up play when the final ball is so poor? That's tough, right? George?
Yeah, like, is this me? Sorry, George.
Either of you. No, go ahead.
Sorry, like, I'll let George come in. I think, like, the first kind of, like, 15 minutes, I was, like, on the edge of me, on the edge of my seat, kind of like in anticipation when we got in those positions. And then like kind of like by after, you know, after a while, I was kind of like, oh, right, we're in these positions, but I kind of knew we wasn't going to score and capitalize on it. So I think that kind of dampens down your enthusiasm for that good build up play. But that's nothing to do with the manager. You know, that's one, you know, the managers are actually, in my opinion, setting the team up quite well. The structure's good. You know, we're getting into dangerous positions. It's just up to the players to execute it. I think Colly Olsha's been very, very good. You know, I think he's a really, really talented player. Yeah. And he's been blessed with speed. You know, that's something you can't coach. But as we've seen in the Prem, he's so quick. And do you know what? He's stronger than people giving credit for. He doesn't really get bullied off the ball. And one thing that my dad also said to me last night was how hard he works off the ball, which is really important too. But his final product is poor, unfortunately.
There were a couple of passes last night, when he got himself in good position.
But like, this isn't me being overcritical. He's just a young kid. But how many wingers do you see at Premier League level who are quite experienced, who don't have that final quality? You know, it's very rare that somebody has those attributes of the speed and the power and complement it with the
final. We had that with McNeil, I think, didn't we?
Yeah, but McNeil could beat a player one-on-one he could get a yard and whip it in, but McNeil couldn't have scored that goal Colly Olsha could at Leeds. So he does have that in product. It's just not quite consistent yet. And, you know, I think we're seeing with another one like Perez he is getting better. He's someone I've been critical of. Perez, for me, is typical of a lot of modern footballers where the fantastic athletes can get up and down, fit as a butcher's dog, but he just lacks quality on the ball, unfortunately. Yeah. You put one good cross into a Colly Olsha bar like he does lack quality. And it's hard, even though you shouldn't do it, it's hard not to compare to that company team. And you're comparing Perez to Matson. And it's unfair on Perez, but Matson was just a lovely footballer to watch, wasn't he?
Yeah, yeah.
And he did have that quality. So if we can just, and then it was the same against Oxford, you know, the build-up play was fine. People are talking about the midfield, you know, and the midfield's not the most creative, but the midfield, in my opinion, is doing an okay job. They're feeding it into those good positions. It's up to your attacking players to then make the most of that. And you're kind of thinking once Brownell got that penalty, you know, we really needed to put our foot on Plymouth's throat.
Yeah.
And if anything, after the goal, we got...
We took it off the gas more and more.
You kind of think, right, we've got that goal, kick on, and we never did. So
lead up to the goal, Rich, that I think we were saying if we score one here, we'll get a bag full.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, and it never happened. And I felt the same would have happened against Oxford, and the opposite happened. And the only thing that really worries me with this team is where is that quality going to come from? And I know we've got players coming back, but that does worry me. That's not a quick fix in terms of getting that final ball right.
If goals are worrying me.
It is a worry. We don't really look like scoring a lot of goals. No. You know, so conceding. So
exactly. Well, we'll come on to the defence in a minute. It's like you say, that's very much George's point. It's if you're going to get yourself up to second in the lead and you are scoring 1-0, you know, you're winning 1-0 games and you don't look like throwing away that 1-0. It's a very solid 1-0. You're not, you know, throwing 11 men behind the ball and really defending for your lives. Then does it really matter? I guess we can talk about this till the cows come home. George, I think for me, we keep talking about Foster, which we'll come on to next. And he's very much out of form at the moment. But I think for me, it's a decent number 10 as well that we're missing in this squad. And it also links back to this situation where I'm still not convinced with this midfield three of Brownhill, Cullen and Hannibal. I think last night was better than it has been, which I think for me thinks, oh, okay, well, is this just getting better? Is it linking better? But it's not, it just feels a little bit in no man's land for me is Hannibal. And we don't, Foster isn't getting a supply line. He's also not making the chances himself either. But it feels like we get to Brownhill and Cullen and it stops. And we either send it out and let Colly Olsha go out on a run off on his own. But then that's it. That's kind of where our attacking line, we get there and it's almost like there's an invisible shield and they all end up stop passing to the side. And that to me is a problem. And now Fleming's going to help that. But when he's not in the squad, it feels like that's a real hole for me.
I think we're a bit unlucky in that we've got two really good number 10s in the squad in Fleming and Aaron Ramsey. Now Aaron Ramsey was pants last season in the Premier League and he looked miles off it. He looked too weak. He looked too naive, too inexperienced. All that being said, the season prior and the season before that, he was fantastic in the Championship. He's got a great track record. You know, with Middlesbrough, he was absolutely superb in that number 10 role. And playing behind the striker, playing on either wing, he was fantastic. He's going to be a great player at this level. So you've got Fleming and you've got Aaron Ramsey there, two fantastic number 10s. We've just got to appreciate both are injured at the moment. Obviously, Fleming will be back this weekend, and I think Fleming could well come in. And if he doesn't come in, he can be a great asset off the bench. Ramsey, okay, we're going to have to wait till Christmas, but it's good that he's nice to see that he's back in training and back on the grass, as Dice would say. But for me, Hannibal's game last night was probably his best half of performance. I thought he was fantastic in the first half. And with Hannibal, I think you've got half the makings of a superb number 10 in that he wins the ball up the pitch so much. He presses so well from the front. He's really, really exemplary in that. And his work rate is just to be applauded. I find him a joy to watch. He's here, there, he's everywhere. He's got a great engine. And yeah, because of that, he does tire in the second half, but he's got that press on him and he's got that ability to win the ball back. Of course, you've got the other side of the game, which is how well are you going to create a chance? How well are you going to drag defenders away? And that's, you know, if he had all those attributes, he wouldn't be playing for Burnley in the Championship, let's be honest, to be at United or have been sold.
I mean, that's a good point, yeah.
A team like Fulham. So for me, that midfield three is doing a good job. As Rich alluded to, they're getting the ball into the wide areas. It's that final ball that's lacking. Coley Oshaw, Parker, to be fair to him, has said in every interview when he speaks about him, he's still got a lot to learn. And that's something, when he first said it, it sort of stuck out to me a bit. I'm thinking, he was great, you know, and Wolves had bid however much in the summer. But the more you watch him, it's fair enough, because his mentality is great. Every time he gets the ball, he wants to take on a fullback. He wants to attack. He's got the pace. He's got the skills to get past them. But it's just that end delivery. But as Rich said, you know, that'll come with time. He's only 20. So for me, the midfield's doing an okay job, and we've just got to appreciate that. We've got a few players out injured. And also, this team's been together for less than 20 days in training. Let's just remember that, you know. Those links aren't going to, you know, all of a sudden come overnight. And I think we'll only get better.
Yeah, no, I agree. Whoever put that in the chat last night genuinely surprised me. I hadn't realised to the extent that was just 20 days. And, you know, it's also, we've played, what, 8 games now? Is that the 8th game? And we have got, you know, the first 3 of them, you discount them because it was a different squad altogether. So we've had 5 games with this squad and he's got us up into second. Rich, let's rip the band-aid off on this one, because this is a delicate discussion, but one that I think needs to be had. Lyle Foster.
Yeah, so me and Tom's had some good debates on this, and it's there's not a simple solution to it. He's not getting loads of service and loads of the kind of balls that he wants. But at the same time, for me, it's not, I know this might sound daft, a striker's role isn't just about scoring goals all the time. It's about opening up space for other players. It's about making it difficult for centre-halves, whether that's having a really good physical contest, whether that's running in behind more. And he's just not, in my opinion, doing enough. He's just not important. Like, Tom's argument is he's getting no service, and I've seen that on Twitter, which I fully get. But then at times, you've got to make stuff happen yourself.
Yeah, you can't completely rely on the rest of the team.
And it's not like, I would argue that point if we've got 25% possession, but we're actually having a lot of the ball. And I thought last night he got involved a bit more. You know, he did make some good runs in behind, and, you know, when we got the ball to him a couple of times. But, like, we can discuss why, and everybody will have their own theories as to why he does. I'm talking about physically, and he is not the same player as we've seen this time last season. He played twice against Aston Villa last season, against top centre half, so top side, and he bullied them. He was unbelievable. You know, and then this season he's getting like beaten in physical contests with defenders from a lower level. He's not outpacing defenders. His touch is poor. He's not making the right decisions. Sometimes he's just trying little fancy flicks. To me, I don't. And like yesterday, he went down with cramp. And I'm like, I know they've played 2 games in a short space of time, but he's not done that. like
we're five games into this season, we've had a break.
Yeah, these should be unbelievably kind of fit athletes, in my opinion. I might be arsy and people are fine to disagree with me. I don't think they should be having cramp with 20 odd minutes to go. Because
so early in the season, I agree.
So early in the season, so like a bit of context. I had to stay at home last night to watch the game. My little girl wasn't too well, so I couldn't go. And when Foster went down with that cramp, you're kind of looking as he twisted his ankle, as the defender kind of stood on him and made contact. It was nothing. It was just purely cramp, and that's why he was able to continue. And then we had another attack, and he pulled up, and Jay went off. And I don't want to be sounding like I'm overcritical, but surely, like, you don't see Brownhill cramping up, do you? Who I imagine would do more running in a game than Foster. You don't see Perez
at the moment,
you know, cramping up, who's up and down that left wing, and you're like, there's something just a little bit amiss. He's either not fully fit, either, you know, physically, probably a bit of a lack of confidence. I know Parker said that when he come back off international duty, had that illness, that's why he didn't play against Leeds. I think the best thing for Foster, you know, if Fleming's fit, is to have just to have a little bit of time. Out of the team, maybe get your fitness back if that is an issue, away from the spotlight, and then come back. And then I seen a stat, I think I put it in the group today, just let me get it. Just I'll go on Wikipedia actually. And I know there's been loads of things with Foster. He come in January, didn't quite settle into the team. He had obviously, unfortunately, had his break with his mental health illness, but he's ultimately scored 7 goals in 42 games in 42 league games. And however you dress it up, that's not a good enough return.
It isn't, but you do have to give him some grace.
I do, and Premier League. And this is why I said that. There is some mitigation. And I don't think it's, you know, but at the same time, and I think every single Burnley fan said it, when you look at our squad, we're desperate and dying for that number 9. You know, and we've not got a goal scorer. And if you look at Parker's promotion teams with Fulham and Bournemouth, you had Mitrovic and Solanke, who scored a lot of goals. So we don't seem to have that, and that is a worry for me. Out of anywhere on the pitch, it's that we don't have that number 9. I think we've got Fleming and Foster, who are different types of players, but I think they're both kind of like in between a 9 and a 10. I think Fleming even said that in his interview, is a little bit of a 9.5. So you've got, to me, you've got two very similar players, and you've not got that like number 9 with a little bit of... Do you know someone who can run off the shoulder, who's got an eye for goal? And, you know, when we're looking to put them balls into the boxes, he finds good positions. And like you said, the balls into the box weren't great, but does Foster have to make better balls to make it, make better runs to make it easier for those wide players to find him?
Well, actually, I'm going to bring George in here because that's what
just
George
for me, just all I want for Foster.
Sorry, I'm just going to bring George in here before you finish that off, Rich, because I think that is a point that George did say then. We've been talking about that final ball, George, and actually, could it be the case that it isn't necessarily our final ball, or could it just be that Foster's failing to find that space?
Sorry, did I go then? Did I go?
Yeah, you're all right. Don't worry. Yeah, don't worry. Fine. Don't worry. You're grand. Don't worry. Don't worry, listeners. We've got him. We've got him back. We lost Rich. So go on, George. Just pick up that point, and we'll head back to Rich.
Yeah, it's easy, isn't it? When say a Coley Oshaw gets to the byline, skips past his man. He's just got into the 18-yard box and cuts it across and say it's not usually the first man, it's usually the second man who's intercepting it and clearing it. And you think, crikey, you know, if it were only for that final ball, could it be that Foster's actually not finding the right run? Could it be he's not finding that yard of space and that defender's intercepting the ball because he's not been able to you know, shoulder his man and find that space to then get a shot away? Could that be the case? I don't know. I think it probably could be. But a word for Foster's credit, because I agree with pretty much everything Rich has said there. And I think Foster's had that Lukaku syndrome in the summer of putting on too much muscle, too much upper body strength. I don't think he's as lean and as quick as we saw in the Premier League and as we've seen in the past. That being said, he did have one fantastic run in behind last night. And you saw that snippet of what he can be, you know, when a team plays a high line. He managed to get back from an offside position and time his run superbly. And he was through on goal and he was unlucky. You know, it was a tough chance to chip the keeper and from a tight angle. It obviously missed on that occasion. But it was just a snippet of what he can be and what we know him to, what we know at his best he can be, which makes it all the more frustrating.
I think that is the thing, isn't it? We know he has got the physical attributes to be a really, really, you know, to be a Premier League level striker, and we maybe took a punt on him. And I think, I can't, was it Mooney, that chief scout, said what we need to coach into Lyon is into Foster is the tactical side of it. Yeah. But what worries me is he's been at the club, it'll be 2 years in January, and I don't think he gets. I think he's tactically not amazing. I don't really see a massive football brain in there, in my opinion. You know, you compare him to Jay when he was young, when he was at a similar age before he got his knee injury. You know, Jay's football intelligence and his football brain was far superior to that of Foster. And you look at a player like Danny Ings or even like Volks. Volks didn't have the physique. He was great in the air, but Gray was another example. Great physical attributes, but he didn't actually understand the game. He was just a runner. And that's what worries me about Foster. And you get to a certain point with a player and you do go, is he that good? And that's where I am with Foster. I'm just 50-50 at the moment with him.
Yeah, I think that's probably fair.
And it's nothing personal, by the way. Like, when we have these discussions, people think that, like, when you're discussing it, it's personal and stuff, and it never is that.
I don't think people do think that, Rich. I think you're...
I do sometimes, a little bit, because you kind of say, oh, Foster's a scapegoat, and then you realise, you know, I think you're just analysing the performance a little bit and what you're judging. And all, I think every single Burnley fan has a lot of sympathy from what Lyle Foster's gone through, and it's not been easy.
Yeah.
We all just really want him to do well, and it's just not happening for him at the moment.
Everybody's rooting for him, but I think there is a separation there, and you can have both. You know, just because we are critical of his play at the moment and the form that he's currently in, doesn't mean that we've suddenly gone all heartless and we don't have concern for his well-being or want to root for him to do well. Like, the two things are not mutually exclusive. You can absolutely have both, you know. And I think everybody is of that opinion. And to be honest, probably people are rooting for him even more than they would do somebody else, because they know that he needs our care and he needs our attention and he needs the support from us more than, for reasons other than just a confidence boost. He needs that support network around him. So yeah, I don't think you need to be too concerned there, Rich. I think people know where you're coming from, don't worry. George, at the other end of the pitch, another clean sheet. There's only one team in the league that has scored more than us, but one team that have conceded less than us. James Trafford, to me, looks like a completely different player. I think he's playing with a confidence and a smile on his face. He looks assured and confident to me. I think this season, we've said it before, this season of the Championship is going to be the absolute making of him, and it's what he needed last year instead of being absolutely thrown to the wolves by company to the Premier League, which was just a nonsense decision. I think we're all very much of the opinion that our defence has taken a hit in terms of quality. We're not massively convinced with the back four, particularly when you get injuries and you're having to pay Humphries and Pires and there's no left back cover. And, you know, and at the moment we seem to have about 45 centre halves at the club and they're all injured. But we're still keeping clean sheets. Now, Rich touched on this earlier to say that actually last night, some of that was down to Plymouth's inadequacies in front of goal, can we say? But, you know, you've got to accept that the Championship doesn't have the quality of strikers and front men as you see in the Championship, in the Premier League, sorry. But we are still doing a good job here. We are looking like we're not going to concede a goal.
Yeah, we definitely are. I mean, we just had the two fixtures, I guess, we're discussing in this episode. We went to Oxford, who had won 3 out of 3 home games this season, and have got a good striker that they rate highly in Mark Hughes. Who annoyingly they kept referring to as a Sparky. I guess it's a funny nickname because of the original arc. It's just nonsense for me, cringy. But anyway, that aside. And then we're up against Plymouth last night, who obviously had Morgan Whittaker, who we you know, tried to sign in the summer. He's a fantastic young player. They have, is it Mark Harris? Yeah. And sorry, I've lost my train of thought there, but we went up against Plymouth last night, who had Hardy as well up front, as well as Morgan Whittaker. So two fantastic players there in their own right. So whilst they didn't create anything last night, you could probably say that we as a team, you know, squeezed them enough that they didn't have the outball. They've been really impressive from back to front so far this season. They've had some really good examples of counter-attacks, and we saw not a sniff of that last night. You know, we've got the two sides of our defensive unit, which is defensively, I think they've been tremendous so far. And in the attacking sense, that's probably where we let down. You know, I think their standard of actual defensive work is second to none. Egan Riley, I think, could be a top 10 championship centre-half, maybe a top 6 centre-half in terms of his defensive game. I thought Estev last night was... Estev's fantastic. You know, we all know... Perez, to his credit, I think he's not been troubled defensively in the last couple of games. And then a word on Bashir Humphreys, who I thought last night was his best game. Yeah, I thought...
Yeah, he was good, actually. Yeah, he was.
Fantastic. He's such a great athlete. He's got real legs on him. And he's so comfortable on the ball. For a guy who's playing at right-back, he's a left-footed centre-half who usually plays in the left centre-back position. And he's taken to that right-back position like a duck to water.
Yeah, he has.
Now, where our problems come, as we all know, and we've discussed the attacking issue, which some people will unfairly lay just at Foster's door or just at the winger's door. It's the defence that contributes to that. We've not got a right back in his natural berth. I think we're missing Connor Roberts massively. We don't have a left back of the same quality of Mattson 2 years ago. And I think one thing that's probably gone under the radar a little bit is in the centre-halves, we've completely lost that ability to bring it through midfield from a centre-back. We know Jordan Bayer was the king of this 2 seasons ago, where he'd pick up the ball, run through their midfield. And this wasn't just the odd occasion. This was all the time. He'd run through their midfield, play it off. And if he's not played it off to a striker, he's played it to another midfielder who's made the space because of Bayer's run. We lost that with Bayer's injury. And Ekdal, to his credit, even though he's as slow as Chris Awolumo, Ekdal was equally as good at getting it, advancing it up the pitch. So I think with the loss of Bayer and Ekdal, we've really lost that. Estev's probably got it in his locker, but just needs to grow that side of his game, which I've no doubt over time he will. So defensively, superb. It's just going forward where we can see the weaknesses, and with players coming back, we'll improve. And hopefully with the natural evolution of a young player like Estev or Humphreys, will get better.
Yeah, definitely. Rich, Jordan Bayer, I can't wait for him to come back. I think we missed...
Like George said, he's just a phenomenal player. It's such a shame he's been injured. I don't think we have... There was mistakes in him in the Premier League, but I don't think he played enough games to really fairly judge him at that level. And when he come into the team, up until he come into the team, we was drawing a lot of games, struggling to break teams down a little bit. And he was a massive part of our success, you know, bringing, like George says, bringing that ball out to defence. I don't know if we'll see him again this season. Fingers crossed we will, because sounds like he's got quite an unusual injury, by the way you described it on Instagram. It's not just like an ACL rupture, something a little bit different.
No, it's quite a serious one, I believe, yeah.
That seems like it's hard to heal, but yeah, I think I just put a message there. He was one of my favourite Burnley players to watch of all time.
Yeah, the 100 points, like, the championship season. Oh, it was amazing.
I was watching Bayer thinking, this is a guy you see Mattson and could tell and I playing like Champions League, winning Bundesliga, as finals of the Champions League. And, you know, obviously Mattson's got a good move to Villa. I was kind of thinking Bayer could go on to that level. It's just not quite happened for him yet. But I think football, it's kind of like your attack starts with your defence and your defence starts with your attack. And I think we've got the defensive side part of it. I think under Kompany, we didn't defend as a team. It was all very reactive and balls would come over and we were running everywhere. We seem to have a really good solid structure. We have a good press about us, but we're also able to stay nice and compact, which is what you hear all the top coaches talk about. But then, like I said, going forward, it's very like just in lines. So it's kind of like centre half to left back, midfield. Everyone stays in the positions. There's no real fluidity to our attacking play. A benefit of that is if you do lose the ball, you're not as susceptible to being counter-attacked on. And this is a big reason we're keeping clean sheets. But when you're quite rigid in your attacking play and you don't have that fluidity and players moving into different positions and all, you know, one-twos and overlaps, you do find it harder to break teams down. And there's also a part of me a little bit that we have kept clean sheets. And it's the back four obviously plays the main part, but like I mentioned before, it's the whole team. And I think a reason why Parker's playing this quite rigid formation in possession is that maybe because we have got an inexperienced back four, he doesn't want them to get overexposed. So say if like Cullen gives the ball away, or Browner gives the ball away in midfield, you've still got that security there. They're not just attacking on your defence. So I think that's another reason why, which I've not seen mentioned much, but that should, that might not be true. It's just a little theory that I've got. I remember Mourinho doing a coach's voice on that, and he said when he had a defence that he didn't overtrust, he would play a little bit more rigid and not have as much fluidity on the ball in case he did lose it. So
yeah, no, I like it. I think it's a great theory. George, we go then this weekend with the second of our derbies. It's the Preston derby. Last time we played them in the Championship, it was just an unbelievably nothing performance from them. They didn't even try and win the game. And I've not seen much from them this season to suggest that they are any stronger technically or a force to be reckoned with. I still think they are one of the sides that are vulnerable to relegation this season. They might just have about enough to stay up, but I think they're going to struggle. What do you want to see from the game on Saturday in terms of an improvement on the second half? How can we capitalise on the brilliant performance from the first half and take it through to the second half?
I think Parker's his final message to the players, or his real message to the players throughout training this week, will just be on that clinicalness, on converting what was it was a fantastic performance in that first half up to that final ball. The way we managed to move the ball up the pitch, the way we managed to keep the ball completely away from Plymouth. At times, they had no idea how to win the ball back. And the way we managed to get the triangles from Humphreys, Hannibal, to Corley Oshaw. I mean, that left-back for Plymouth, my word. Oh, God, he should have called in sick at half-time. We were having that much of a mare against Corley Oshaw. So it's just converting that and capitalising, making it one, not only 1-0, but making it 2-0 and possibly 3-0. And then if we do get to 3-0, not shutting up shop like we did under Company against Preston, which we all have still stuck in our throats because it was so annoying. We were absolutely battering them that day, but
we wanted to turn the screen.
Oh, infuriating. So I think that's the message from Parker this week is just getting that clinical side of the game. And it's possibly not something we will see. I don't think we'll roll them over. I do agree with Rich in that we've got this rigid structure because we've got a young left-sided centre-back playing at right-back. We've got Perez, who's getting used to English football. We've got Egan Riley, who's barely played any football for 3 years. So we've got an experienced back line there. But because of that, we're playing this tight structure. To his credit, Rich put in the chat earlier that Hannibal's playing as a sort of defensive number 10. And perhaps that's why we're not seeing the most of his attacking game, because he knows he's got to be up and down that pitch and intercepting the ball. We are rigid. We aren't the most free-flowing attacking football. I don't expect us to steamroll Preston. I think they'll be set up well under Heckingbottom. But as long as we can come away with 3 points, I mean, wow, we'll be looking good going into that break. We really will.
Yeah, we will. Rich, any tweaks to the side for you?
I think it depends on player selection. I think, George, I agree with everything you said about Humphreys. I think he's done admirably, but I pronounced that terribly then.
We got it.
You can see at times when he gets the ball, because he is left-footed, it does slow the attack down a little bit. So it's not like I'm crying out for Roberts as the individual to come back into the team. We're just crying out for an actual proper right-back to come into the team, and I think it'll help. I would like to see Corley Oshaw on the left too, but if Corley Oshaw is playing on the right, I think that'll help him, because I think he'll get a little bit more space. I think though Roberts will overlap better, be a bit better on the ball. So, and it's I think Parker did mention that he should be available, but he's also alluded to that for the last 2 weekends as well, and he's still not been fit, but he's also been named in the Wales squad, so that's a good sign. If Fleming's fit, I'd also put him in for Foster.
What's with Fleming, do we know?
I think he said hamstring, but again, I don't know how serious that is. Frustrating. Like I said, he didn't play a lot for Millwall, so I don't know if he's like come back into the team kind of like that.
It's a step up when you come up to a Premier League.
Yeah, it is, and maybe the intensity of it and the, you know, I can imagine it's been a whirlwind for Fleming since he came in. So, you know, I kind of imagine mentally it's been quite exhausting from him, and then that can translate into the physical side of it as well. And then this is going off topic, but any cricket fans out there, they might have seen that Josh Hull is injured for the Pakistan series, and Stuart Broad alluded to that. When you step up a level, you're more likely to get injuries because of just a different intensity and your body's not used to it. And like Fleming's first game was against Leeds, he got chucked into it, but fingers crossed he is fit. I think if them two come in, it will help us. I don't know what's up with Warrell. I've heard rumours of a broken foot on Twitter. Don't have a clue how true they are.
Oh, I heard that. Yeah.
That is true again. Sometimes rumours on Twitter are true, and then other times they're not. So it is hard to judge. But I think those are the only two changes that I would look to make. I think Hannibal's a funny one for me, because I think, like, first half he gives you great energy, but maybe because he runs himself into the ground, he does get knackered. He gets knackered quite quickly into the second half. Because he played Monday, Tuesday, I'd be 50-50 to bring Laurent into the team and maybe put Brownell into that number 10. I know George might disagree with that. I think Laurent's not as good on the ball, but he gives you that drive forward, and I think that's something that we're missing a little bit. You know, even when he come on last night, he got us up the pitch. And I think, so that's maybe a tweak I might have. And it's nothing against Hannibal, just maybe give him a little bit of a breather. But I'm 50-50 on that one. But for me, I'd like Roberts and Fleming definitely back in the team.
Love it. Excellent. Well, let's wrap that up there. We've got a Lancashire derby to look forward to at the weekend. We're sitting pretty second in the league. And as it stands at the moment, we're in the automatic promotion phase. It's a long, old season to go. We've got a side that are getting better and better, a manager that's brimming with confidence and is just making better decisions every week. And he's engaging with his fans and he's explaining his decisions and he's explaining what he thinks went wrong, what he thinks went right, what he's going to do about it. And I think we all need to be enjoying the communication that's coming, because it wasn't always like that under our previous manager. It was quite a closed shop. We didn't always we got politicians' answers, I think, to a lot of questions that were raised in the press. So let's enjoy Scott Parker, and then let's just enjoy being at the top of the table right now. Who knows what this season will bring. My thanks to George and Rich for joining me this week to bring us this analysis show. Dave and I will be back on Friday night with a preview show with our special guest from Deepdale, to give us all the lowdown ahead of our visitors this weekend. If you've got any comments or suggestions, then you know how to find us. Connect with us on social media. But before you leave us this week, do hit that subscribe button, please. If you're watching on our YouTube channel, there's a very handy subscribe button right below you. If you're listening to this through our podcast channels, you can hit the subscribe button through any of your preferred podcast providers. Switch on those notifications and never miss an episode of the Known and Ever podcast. I've been Natalie Bromley. This has been the Known and Ever podcast. Until next time. The Known and Ever podcast is brought to you in association with the TalkSport Fan Network. Our host and editor is Natalie Bromley, and the show is produced by Matt Moss. Our resident statistician is Dave Roberts, and our FPL expert is Adam Dennett. The analysis show team is collectively Tom Whittaker, Rich Steele, George Poole, Charlotte Rigby, and Adam Dennett. Our music is provided by George Gaskell, and our newsletter team is headed up by Jamie Smith. If you don't already, you can subscribe to our newsletter by visiting knownandever.substack.com. Thanks as ever go to our partners TalkSport. We are proud to be associated with the TalkSport Fan Network.